excited about a wonderful service we're going to have today. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Would you stand together with us, please? We want you to worship the Lord with us now as we sing together. We're going to consider the resurrection of Christ, Him being our risen Savior. Let's all sing together. This day, but for the cross we praise Him. It's called in this song the Mercy Tree. You sing together with us.
On a hill called Calvary, there stands an endless mercy tree. Every broken, weary soul, find your rest and be made whole. Stars, pure love, release.
That's why we're here today. That's what we celebrate. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. And because he lives, we can live. And not just have any life, we can have eternal life. We can have abundant life. We can have hope and peace and experience that same victory over death, hell, and the grave. So we're so glad that you're here with us today. We've had 4 wonderful Easter services, and this one's going to be no exception. We're excited to have you here. I see a lot of young families with us today as well. We're so glad to have you there. We've got some of the world's best nurseries, too. If you need to take advantage of that, feel free to do that. And we're just so glad that you're here. If you're here visiting with us for the first time, we'd love to extend a welcome from our church family to you. We're so glad that you are our special guests today. And in your handout that you received on the way in, we've got a connect card, and we'd love to connect with you as you connect with us. And as you are dismissed today, we've got guest tables that are sprinkled all over our lobbies and even a few here in our auditorium. And if you just drop that card off, let us know how you heard about Lancaster Baptist Church. Maybe it was a friend or a flyer left on your door. We'd love to hear that. And then we've got a gift for you. We've got a gift bag. And one of the resources in that bag is this courageous 50-day devotional that I know will be an encouragement to you. Well, as we begin the service, let's start with a word of prayer. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the reason that we celebrate today. We thank you that we can have life because of the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus. But we thank you for the fact that he not only died for our sins, but he rose again and conquered death, hell, and the grave. Lord, be with us today as we celebrate that. I pray that today's service would be an encouragement to all that are here today. And God, I pray that if there's someone here visiting with us, or maybe someone who's been a few times, just doesn't have a relationship with you through your Son, Jesus, that they would find that hope today. Lord, we pray that you'd be with this service, be glorified and honored by it. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Thank you.
thrown away, the same power alive in us today. King Jesus, we call upon your name, no other name. The same power that rolled the stone away, the same power alive in us today. King Jesus, we call.
Precious blood, now he Even if I face death, I would never deny him. At least, that's what I said. And it's what I believe. I had spent the last 3 years following him. "Peter," he said, "follow me, and I will make you become a fisher of men." When he fed that multitude with 5 loaves and 2 small fishes, I was there. When he raised Lazarus from the grave, I was there. When we had a Passover meal and he washed our feet, I was there too.
I was used to having answers. I was a Pharisee, a member of the ruling Sanhedrin. All of my adult life, as I passed through the streets, people clamored for my attention. "Rabbi Nicodemus, teacher, tell us, what does this passage mean? How is this law applied? What is your interpretation of this verse?" This was my life. It was wrapped up in the Torah and in my role as a spiritual leader. But all of this began to crumble when I met him. I saw him do things that defied explanation. He healed lepers. He gave sight to the blind. And his teaching, he spoke with an authority and understanding greater than anything I have ever heard before. How was this possible? Who was this radical from Nazareth? For the first time in my life, I felt uncertainty creeping into my mind. I was supposed to be the man with answers, but now it seemed I had nothing but questions. I had to meet with him. I had to talk to him for myself. But I could not see him publicly, not in front of the others. So I came to him under the cover of night.
I was completely out of control, out of my mind, guilty and hopeless, oppressed and controlled by demons and dark spirits. I was just Mary Magdalene, a woman in desperate need of salvation. So many in our town, so many in our own family, forsook and neglected me. People went out of their way to avoid being near me, but not him. When I was desperate, hopeless, lost, and alone, he came to me. He not only healed me, he saw me. He accepted me. He rescued me.
I came to him by night, and he did meet with me. I wanted to quiz him about his approach to the Torah, about his background and schooling. But he turned straight to me. With both compassion and authority, he told me that I must be born again. I will never forget as he looked into my eyes and said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." The words he spoke were different than the rules and religion I had been trusting in, and I was sure there was something genuine and holy about this man.
No silver or gold could weigh on the scale of glory. No treasure of mine could pay to the debt of mercy. The things of earth will surely fade away. One pardon will prevail. Jesus' blood has ransomed me, has raised me up and washed me.
For the cross, there is now no
For years, I followed him. I worshipped him. There was so much confusion about who he was, but I knew the truth. You see, I had experienced the truth. He turned my life from darkness to light. I did not understand everything about it, but I knew without a doubt that he was God in the flesh sent to be our Savior.
Too popular, too unconventional, too, well, everything. That was the determination of my colleagues. Jesus was making himself out to be our Messiah, and they determined that he had to be stopped. I tried to give perspective and be a voice of reason, but the truth was, they hated him. There had been times in the past that I had questioned our court's judgments, but I never thought I would see the day that Caiaphas, our high priest, to have an innocent man condemned to death.
I couldn't believe it. I knew we had upset the Pharisees. I knew the high priest Caiaphas opposed our ministry. But that? I was not expecting that. Jesus said we were going to rule with him in his kingdom. So when he was arrested and tried, it shook everything I had come to expect. I know that he had tried to warn me, but I never really believed it. There wasn't room in my mind to grasp it until he actually was arrested. And then at his trial, that woman outside, she asked me, "Didn't I see you with him?" I know I should have been strong, but I was so scared, I denied it. And then another one asked, another. Three times they asked. Three different people were convinced of something I should have been proud of. That I was a disciple of Jesus. But I cursed and told them I never knew the man. And now I'm ashamed. I strayed so far.
Caiaphas and the other Pharisees had him arrested. I could not leave. I had to stay, had to watch the unimaginable, the unthinkable. They hired people literally off the street to testify against him. The Pharisees riled the crowd to cry for his crucifixion and sentenced him to death by crucifixion. Jesus did not even resist. I could see in his eyes pain, yes, but there was more. I could see compassion and forgiveness. As the soldiers nailed him to the cross, I heard him say, "Father, forgive them. They know not what they do." He was a man full of love.
I could no longer hide my belief. I knew it would be the end of my authority and my position inside the Sanhedrin. But what good was that now? He had opened my heart. I had watched him from a distance for years. Now, I was ready to follow him. But he was dead. Until he wasn't.
Days later, as we went to take spices to anoint his body, when we arrived at the tomb, it was empty. It was also unexpected and confusing. But I saw an angel who spoke to us and said, "He is not here, for he is risen, as he said."
At Sunday morning, when Mary came running, out of breath, she had been to the tomb and he was not there. I was convinced she had lost her mind. But John and I went to see for ourselves. We couldn't believe our eyes. saw the empty tomb and his burial clothes folded, we knew he was alive again. Most of the others were filled with hope and excitement, but me, I knew what I had done. So I went back to my old life. I went back to fishing. I was not going to face him again. I was humiliated and filled with grief. But that did not deter him. He came to me. He asked if I loved him, and he knew that I did. With compassion and resolve, he told me that he was not through with me. I had left him, but he would never leave me. He still had a plan and purpose for my life. I had wandered from him, but he lovingly guided me back to a relationship with him.
On the hill of Calvary,
My name is Eric, Eric Aguilar, and I actually joined Lancaster Baptist in late October. I feel like my story resonates with Peter a lot, because not only did I understand that Peter was a real true disciple for God, but he also had strayed away. And once he strayed away, he knew that he had nothing left.
My name is Friday, and my last name is Roland Arohan. And I've been attending the Lancaster Baptist Church since October last year. In a lot of ways, my story is like Nicodemus in the Bible, when he went to Jesus and said, you know, how can I be born again?
My name is Mary Ledesma, and I've been at Lancaster Baptist since 2015. Before I started coming, I was a party person, a club hopper, strip clubs, dance clubs, and just had a horrible, just life, no peace, just depressed all the time, and I just wanted a lot of attention, so I was seeking attention in the wrong areas. What came with my party life was 5 kids, then I became a single mom, and then even more depression, because I realized that all that stuff that I got into, it didn't do anything but just make things worse. In my life, it's like Mary Magdalene. I had a lot of chaos in my life, like how she did, and just like how Jesus set her free, he also set me free.
I was very young. I was 17, hadn't even graduated high school. So I ended up straying away from God, almost lost my mother, and never grew up with dad. I became homeless. I was homeless for 2 years. And from there, I started feeling like God was against me, so I strayed away from him.
You know, I was raised in a Christian home, went to a Christian school, so I never really knew, you know, what it is to actually walk the way of Christ. I was just basically like, you know, just going to church for the name of it.
One of my friends, I met her at the gym, and you know, she started attending the Bible college. I started asking her questions about God, and because of that, I was able to attend Lancaster Baptist, and I got saved that same day.
And I talked to my sister Jacqueline, and she said, well, I went to Lancaster Baptist, and I learned, I'm growing, the message is good. And then just the horrible situations that I was in, I was like, I'm broken, I do need Jesus, so I accept him.
One of my other family members, one time they came over to fellowship at Lancaster Baptist Church, we came over, and I was touched by the preaching that day. Brother Jerry showed up on my door. He came over. We sat in my living room, so we went back and forth. Then they asked me if I'm ready to give my life to Christ. You know, I said yes.
And now, I feel like I have filled that void of emptiness inside of me with peace, and that comes from Jesus Christ.
Well, I don't worry about anything anymore. I used to always be stressed out, worrying about bills, everything. And now I just know he's gonna work it out. So I just go day by day, just trusting the Lord. I'm a lot stronger now through those trials. And I know whatever I go through, he has a purpose for it.
It took a lot of fear away from me. Christ has paid, the way for us already, that as long as I receive him as my personal savior, and he has always forgiven me for all I have done.
This is our
feel like we can all relate to that, to like pain, anxieties, and overthinking and stuff. And we have one antidote, and that's Jesus Christ. And when I actually willingly, you know, seeked him, he started unraveling, like, you know, all the things that, you know, I had inside. He turned my heart from stone to you know, very tender. And now, like, you know, it just seeing the miraculous, you know, events that have happened in my life, like my mother, she's doing amazing. You know, I'm doing great. And I'm a firm believer that, you know, God has actually used my trials to really build a strong foundation.
Me and my children, we all got baptized. And, you know, a lot has changed. My Christian life becomes so strong now. When I meet somebody that I want to share the word of God with, I share as much as I can by telling them, oh, you know, the Lord is good. You know, someone saying, no matter what the problem is, it's gonna have your back.
I said, okay, Lord, I'm gonna wait for you. I'm gonna trust you, you know, and if you want me to have a husband, I'll have one. And he did bless me with a husband. I'm a wonderful husband. And I started over, and we have a four-year-old son, Nehemiah. Now, because of me being in Lancaster Baptist and growing, you know, my life's changed, you know, and now I can raise a son that has a dad and a mom.
Choir, would you join me in thanking the choir once again and the orchestra for a job well done? I've heard the presentation four times now, and every time has been such a blessing. And my favorite part is the part where people are testifying about how their lives have been changed. And that's why I moved to Lancaster 38 years ago, was to see the power of the gospel change lives. And I believe he wants to change lives in this service today as well. And that's why we're so glad you're here. I want you to look at your notes that were given to you and find the passage of Scripture called Luke 24. And we're going to take just a few moments as we conclude our program to look to the Word of God and to understand the basis for all these songs and all of this life change. And if you would stand with me, please, for the Scripture reading from Luke 24. I'd like to read beginning in verse 1. And I'm going to speak on the subject, the expectation of resurrection. And again, I'm so glad that you're here today. And let's learn from the Word of God about this resurrection story as we open to Luke chapter 24 today. Let's read the first 8 verses. Now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulchre, bringing the spices which they had prepared, and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulchre. And they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid and bowed down their faces to the earth, they said unto them, why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, and be crucified, and the third day rise again. And they remembered his words. Let's say that last phrase together. And they remembered his words. Let's pray. Lord, I ask that you would help us to remember the words that perhaps some of us learned as children. Perhaps some have never heard them and will hear them for the first time today. But open our understanding to your words, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Jesus had clearly taught that he would rise again. He had prophesied it over and over during his earthly ministry. But somehow on that first resurrection morning, when those women were walking to the tomb, it just seemed like empty words. It just seemed like something maybe even from another lifetime. After all, the early Christians, they had seen Pontius Pilate as he allowed the Lord to be scourged. They saw when Pontius Pilate delivered Jesus to the angry mob, and when Jesus was beaten with the cat of nine tails, when he walked up the hill called Calvary, the hill of the skull, and there they heard as the nails were pounded into the hands of Jesus and into the feet of Jesus. They had seen Jesus as he was lifted up on the cross and then dropped into the hole of earth. They saw as his blood came flowing from his hands and from his brow where the crown of thorns had pierced. All of this, no doubt, had placed them in a state of shock to see their Savior suffering with such anguish. They were stunned. And now, as these three women in Luke 24, led by Mary Magdalene, come to this garden tomb, they are going to be shocked once again because they are not prepared for what they are about to see on that first Easter morning. They were not expecting to see the stone rolled away in this fashion. They were not expecting to see an empty tomb. I want you to visit with me in these final few moments this morning, the site, the place. I want you to feel with me the emotion that these women must have felt that first morning. When I think of the emotion of the first resurrection morning, I think of jubilance and joy. But that was not the case in the very first moments for these three women. They had brought the traditional burial spices. They wanted to do something for Jesus, even though he was now no longer with them. They thought they could prepare his body for the burial. Mary Magdalene, from the little town of Magdala, a town that I have visited there near the Sea of Galilee, not far from Capernaum, where Jesus did so many miracles. Mary Magdalene, the Bible tells us, had seven devils. She was a woman under great demonic oppression. And Jesus Christ had set her free and put a smile on her face and given her a home for all of eternity. And her life had been touched and changed. And yet now, as she approached the empty tomb, the Bible says that they were perplexed. These women were in a state of being perplexed, the Bible says in verse 4. They were much perplexed, meaning they were completely puzzled. They were entirely at a loss. In fact, John's gospel says that Mary Magdalene thought that perhaps someone had stolen the body of Jesus Christ. Whatever the case, they had forgotten the words of Jesus. Jesus said in Matthew 12, "For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth." Here we see that Jesus had prophesied his own death, burial, and resurrection. This is one of the many reasons we believe that he is fully God and fully man, for he alone could prophesy and fulfill his own death, burial, and resurrection. He had said to them in John 10, 17, "Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life that I might take it back again." Who can take their life back again except for God be in him and with him, except in this case, he be God himself? Here we see these ladies so perplexed because they had forgotten the words that Jesus had spoken. They were not only perplexed, they were afraid. The Bible says in verse 5, "And as they were afraid." And I believe I would have been afraid too. The Bible says in verse 4 that as they stood there, two men stood by them in shining garments. Imagine they're standing there, they're perplexed at what they are seeing, and suddenly two angelic beings show up right next to them. I don't know about you, but that's a little bit frightening to think of it. And yet the Bible says this was their experience, perplexed and afraid. But not only were the angels there, the angels began talking to them. And the Bible says that the angel said in verse number 5, "Why seek ye the living amongst the dead? What are you doing here in the graveyard looking for someone that said he would be alive?" And suddenly, all through the spectrum of emotions, these women are experiencing a form of anxiety and questioning and a type of blurriness that they had never experienced before. Sorrow and grief, perplexity, shock and fear. Even now, confusion had come into their own hearts. And sometimes in our lives, when we have shocking moments, times of loss and difficulty, we also can go through a season of emotion that causes us to question whether there is a God, that questions whether the Bible's true, and we can find ourselves wondering what is reality. And I would say we should not be too harsh on these women, because all of us can understand in emotional times it's difficult to get a hold of the truth. Sometimes it's hard to remember what we should have already known, as in this case. It reminds me of the story of an Easter play that was put on at a church, and there was a little boy named Billy. He's 5 years old, and he was given a line for the play. His line was very simple. His line was, "He is not here, he is risen." That was his line. Let's say it together and see how smart we are. "He is not here, he is risen." Very good. That was Billy's line. And so the drama was going on, and it came time for his line, and all of a sudden he got stage fright. He could not remember what to say, and the producer had to come up and whisper into his ear. Billy had a smile on his face. He grabbed that microphone. He said, "He is not here. He is in prison." And again, it just sometimes takes a while until the truth can settle in and we can actually get it right. The emotion of that first Easter was not initially joy, it was fear, it was confusion. And oftentimes, those are the emotions that people right here in the Antelope Valley face every single day. And that's why we need, secondly, to move to the evidence that is in front of us, to move from emotion to evidence. Because emotions are unreliable. Emotions cause us to make poor decisions, but we must come to study and understand the evidence of resurrection. The Bible says in verse 6, "He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again." What is the evidence of Christianity? Why do we have such staunch faith in the fact that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, and that no one comes to the Father except through Christ? Why such adamance on such a fact? Well, the fact of the matter is, the evidence points us, first of all, to an empty tomb. This was the evidence the women saw that morning. In fact, the Bible tells us concerning this tomb that Pontius Pilate had placed a Roman guard at the tomb. They were so afraid that the Christian disciples might steal the body of Jesus and claim a resurrection that they placed Roman soldiers at the tomb. And the Bible says in Matthew 27:65, "And Pilate said, Have a watch, go your way, make it as sure as you can. So they went and made the sepulcher sure, sealing the stone and setting a watch." Pilate said, "Make it as sure as you can." No one would have ever expected a burial place guarded by soldiers, sealed with a stone that weighed hundreds and hundreds of pounds, perhaps thousands of pounds. No one would have ever expected that this stone would have been rolled away. And yet the Bible says in Matthew 28 and verse 2, "And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning,
and his raiment was white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. These mighty Roman soldiers that had seen much war and had been through much difficulty, they shook like children. They were full of fear. They left their place of duty because the tomb that they were supposed to guard was now empty. The cornerstone of our Christian faith is the empty tomb of Jesus Christ. But not only do we see the empty tomb on this Easter morning, but we're reminded of the folded grave clothes. Very significant and unique indeed. The Bible says in verse 12, "Then arose Peter and ran unto the sepulcher, and stooping down, he beheld the linen clothes laid by themselves, and departed, wondering in himself at which had come to pass." Notice it says, "the linen clothes laid by themselves." The clothes that Jesus Christ was wearing, these burial clothes, are now laid neatly in the place where Jesus Christ vacated them upon his resurrection. Furthermore, the Bible says in John 20 and verse 6, "And the napkin that was about his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself." In other words, they found an empty tomb, and they found neatly wrapped the burial clothing of the Lord Jesus Christ as evidence to his having vacated this place. His body was not stolen. The linen clothes were not stolen. He vacated the tomb and the clothing when he ascended up into heaven. And how we thank God this morning, of all things, for the significance of the empty tomb. When you think about the burial places around the world that are known and that are famous, you might think of the pyramids of Egypt. They are famous because they contain the mummified bodies of the ancient pharaohs. You might think of Westminster Abbey. I visited there a few times, and I've seen the burial of famous people such as David Livingstone. I've seen the burial of many of the kings and queens of England there in Westminster Abbey. Their bodies are laid to rest there. Mohammed's tomb in Medina, Saudi Arabia, is noted for the stone coffin and for the bones that are in the coffin. The Taj Mahal in India was built as a memorial for the wife to the wife of one of the Shahs of that country. Arlington Cemetery in Washington, D.C. is the honored resting place of many outstanding Americans. But the garden tomb of Jesus Christ is famous not because of what is inside. It is famous because it is empty today. Jesus Christ is alive and seated at the right hand of God, the Heavenly Father. Evidence. You can't continue living a life of anxiety, emotion, and going from place to place, philosophy to philosophy, religion to religion. There comes a time when you must move from the emotion of a moment into the evidence that is based on the Scripture. And the evidence for Christ is the empty tomb and the folded grave clothes and the heavenly testimony of the angel that came down and that said, "Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen as he said." God sent down his own messengers to testify of the resurrected Christ and to remind them that he had promised that on the third day he would raise up again. The Bible says in Acts chapter 1 and verse 3, "To whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God." Time does not allow us this morning, but please understand that over the 40 days after his resurrection, Jesus Christ was seen by 1,500 eyewitnesses. 1,500 times someone saw the resurrected Christ. Evidence of the empty tomb, evidence of the folded garment, evidence of the testimony from heaven, evidence of 1,500 witnesses on the earth. My friend, put your faith in the evidence of Jesus Christ this morning. Jesus Christ is calling this world to move from the emotion of false religion to the evidence of the empty tomb. But I want you to notice not only the emotion of that first resurrection, not only the evidence of that first resurrection, but finally, the expectation. When someone puts their faith in Jesus Christ, when someone believes in the death, burial, and resurrection, the expectation for life and for eternal life is radically, radically changed. The Bible tells us this expectation began in verse 8. It says, and they remembered his words. Nobody will ever move from emotion into a relationship with Christ until they come by way of the Word of God. Romans 10, 17, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. You may not like a joke I tell today. You may not like one of the songs the choir sings today. But my friend, we must put our faith in the Word of God. And they remembered his words. Some of you have heard, maybe a radio broadcast, maybe as a child in Bible school, maybe a godly grandmother. Along your life's journey in the United States of America, you have probably heard a bit of the Word of God here and there. It is time to revive the Word in our heart and in our life. The Bible is clear that the expectation of these women was based upon the Word of God. And it is only man's word that really matters. Only God's word that really matters. Man's word oftentimes falls so short of our expectation. But God's word never fails. It is wholly trustworthy. I heard about a letter that was written to a man named Johnny, and the letter said, "Dear Johnny, no words could express my unhappiness since I broke off our engagement. Please, please say you'll take me back. I love you. I love you. I love you. Love always, Jane. P.S. Congratulations on winning the lottery." How many of you would question Jane's sincerity? And that's how man's word is so often. I've dealt with thousands and thousands of men in business situations and ministry situations, and I can tell you that man's word is not always true, but God's word has never failed me, not one time. They remembered his words. God had promised a resurrection. 1 Corinthians 15:3. "For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." The Bible predicted the time that Jesus would come. The Bible predicted the way that he would come, that he would be born of a virgin. The Bible predicted that his body would be pierced, that his blood would be shed, that not a bone of him would be broken. Throughout the Scriptures of the Old Testament, specifically in Isaiah, there was given a prophecy that Jesus would come. And these fulfilled prophecies are why we hold to the veracity, the truthfulness of the Word of God. He had told them that it would be this way. He had promised his coming resurrection. There was a Muslim in Africa who became a Christian. And some of his friends said, "How can you do that? How can you become a Christian?" He said, "Well, it's like this. Suppose you were walking down a path, and you're walking down the path, and suddenly there comes a fork in the road, and you have a decision. You're not sure which way to go, and you see two men, and one man is alive, and one man is dead. Which one would you ask to show you the way?" And my friend, Jesus Christ is alive, and through his word, he is showing us the way this morning. And I challenge you to follow Jesus Christ, who is the way, the truth, and the life. He promised that he would be resurrected, and Mary Magdalene believed. And when she saw him on another occasion after his resurrection, she thought he was the gardener. And Jesus said, "Mary," and she recognized that voice, I'm sure. She turned towards Jesus and she said, "Rabboni," which is to say, "Master." She put her trust in Jesus Christ. John 20 and 28, we read about a man named Thomas. In the Bible, he was called sometimes Thomas the Doubter. He struggled to have faith at times. And when he saw the Lord, the resurrected Christ, he said, "Oh, my Lord and my God." And Jesus saith unto him, "Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus says, even though you've not seen me physically, those who have not seen me but have heard of me and have believed on me, they are blessed indeed. And so our expectation concerning our relationship with God is from the Word of God. Secondly, when I put my trust in the Word and when I follow after Jesus Christ, this will provide redemption for my life. Now, redemption, that is to say that God purchases me back from my lost condition and that God has redeemed me by the blood that was shed on Calvary. Now, why would Jesus have to shed his blood? Why did Jesus come and die on that cross? A very simple answer in the Bible. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. How many of you have ever heard of a man named Adam, the first man of the human race? Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve. They were the first two people recorded in the book of beginnings, the book of Genesis. And the Bible says that Adam and Eve were tempted with sin by Satan. And the Bible says that they were the first to sin. And the Bible tells us, wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so death passed upon all men, for all have sinned. Now, I don't want to be overly negative this morning, but according to the scriptures, the human race is a fallen race. If you don't believe that, go watch the nursery in a few minutes. Some of your children are in there right now pulling the hair of the other children. And we don't have to teach them how to do that. They just kind of figure it out, don't they? Why? For all have sinned. We're all sinners. And we all come short of the glory of God. And we all need redemption. And we've got to find redemption. And where do we find redemption? We find it in the cross of Jesus Christ. The Bible is so clear that Jesus Christ came and that God commended his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. I heard about a boy talking to his friend, and his friend said, "How'd you get those bruises all over your arm?" He said, "Oh, I ate some chocolate Easter eggs." He said, "I didn't know you get bruises from chocolate Easter eggs." He said, "They were my brother's Easter eggs." All have sinned. But Colossians 1:14 says that there is redemption in the blood of Jesus Christ. Please understand this. Jesus shed his blood to pay the price, to purchase you out of condemnation, and to give you eternal life in heaven. This church cannot give you a trip to heaven. This church cannot wash away your sin. The Baptist church cannot do that. The Catholic church cannot do that. I cannot do that. The Pope cannot do that. Baptistry Waters cannot do that. There is only one way of redemption, and that is by the way of the cross of Jesus Christ. He alone is our Redeemer. Mary is not the Redeemer. The church is not the Redeemer. Jesus Christ is our Redeemer. And he rose up from the grave in order that we might be justified, just as if we had never sinned. He was delivered for our offenses and was raised for our justification. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. My expectation today is based upon the Word of God. It is based upon the Son of God who provides redemption. And ultimately and finally, he provides eternal life. Now, in these next 3 minutes, make sure you don't miss a word. Because eternal life is only available through Jesus Christ. The redeemed man or woman, the redeemed child, can know that they have eternal life. The Bible says in Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, if you go work a job this week and maybe work for a week or two, you're going to have a wage at the end of that period. It's your deserving payment. Hopefully you've worked hard and you deserve a payment. It's called a wage. That's what you deserve. And God says the wage of sin is death. What I deserve because of my sin nature is separation from God for all of eternity. In fact, it's in a place, sad to say, called hell. But the Bible says God is not willing that anyone should perish. He's desirous that all would come to repentance. In other words, that everyone would turn to him. It's not his desire that we would perish. Nevertheless, the wages of our sin, what I deserve, is death. But God has a gift. And that gift has been paid for by the blood of Jesus. It is the gift of God, which is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life." Only the Son of God, only the Redeemer can give eternal life. Jesus said, "I give eternal life. You can come to me and I might give you a wafer at communion or juice at communion, but I cannot give you salvation, and that wafer and that juice cannot give you salvation. You can get baptized in water, but water does not wash away sin. The only person that can give salvation is Jesus. He said, I will give eternal life. It is His blood that brings redemption. It is His eternal life based upon the resurrection that we're trusting in even to this day. And so, this is what He says finally in 1 Peter 1:3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to His abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope. Listen. A lively hope by or because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We have an expectation of hope because our expectation is in Jesus Christ, and He was the first fruits of the resurrection, the first one to conquer death and the grave, and all who are in Christ can have the same hope. And the Bible says that we will have an inheritance, incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven. If you trust Christ as your Savior, you can have an inheritance in a place called heaven for all of eternity. I was doing some reading about Prince William and Kate the other day, and Kate, of course, is struggling with cancer, and many people are praying for her, and I noticed that they have their son William is an 11-year-old boy now, and he's second in line to the throne after only his father. And I read that should he ascend to the throne, his inheritance would be $1 billion. $1 billion. How many of you would like to have an inheritance of $1? Right? $1 billion. But then I began to think about even the royal family. And I began to think about a great-grandmother last year who went to heaven, I believe a saved woman. She had trusted the Lord as her Savior, Queen Elizabeth. And then I think about the King of England today struggling with cancer. I think about Kate going through chemotherapy, going through abdominal surgery. All of this reminds us of what the Bible says. What is life? It is a vapor. It appears for a little while, and then it's gone away. And what we need to understand are the words of Jesus who said, what does it gain a man? What does it prosper a man if he gains the whole world, but he loses his soul? And I'm simply saying to you this morning, let other people live their life simply for the inheritance of this world. Jesus Christ is offering you an eternal inheritance in heaven as a free gift if you would believe on His finished work. This is our inheritance. This is our hope in Jesus Christ. It is incorruptible. It is undefiled. It will never fade away. And it can be reserved by any person who believes on the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, no one has the expectation of heaven if they have never received Christ as their Savior. John 1:12 says, but as many as received Him, to them gave He power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on His name. As many as believe Him, we must believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. This past Tuesday morning, we were getting ready for our day, and my wife Terry said, honey, I need to go to Costco today. And I said, have a good time. And she said something like, there's a lot of heavy stuff I got to get over there at Costco. And I know a hint when a hint's being dropped, you know what I'm saying? And so I said, all right. And at lunchtime, we ran over to Costco, and there were a lot of lines in there, a lot of people eating the free samples. So many people eating free samples, I never got one free sample. I will make up for it today at lunch, I'm sure. And we got all the stuff we needed for Easter, and we came through and paid. And if you've ever been to Costco, they will not let you out of that store unless you produce for them a what? A receipt. They literally check the receipt before you go out. And they want that receipt because the receipt is proof of payment. They want to know the stuff is paid for. What a thought. They want proof of payment. Jesus Christ has provided evidentiary proof of payment for your sin and mine. The proof of the payment was the cross upon which He died and the empty tomb that exists even still to this day in the city of Jerusalem. I've seen it with my own eyes. I've been inside of it. I'm going to tell you that the tomb of Jesus Christ says, all of your sins are paid for in full. The shame, the past mistakes, the rejection, the slavery, the spiritual death, all of it paid by the blood of Jesus Christ. You don't have to do stuff to get to heaven. All you must do is turn and place your total reliance upon Jesus Christ, death, burial, and resurrection, and your sin is paid in full by that faith in Jesus Christ. It's not something that you have to keep paying for. Some religions say, well, do this and do that. If you don't do enough, we'll have your relatives pay after you're dead even. So maybe you can get up into heaven somehow, but that's not the message of Jesus. Jesus said, I took care of the bill for you. I paid for your sin on the cross. Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Friends, today, we need to come out of that emotion. We need to look at the evidence, and then we need to trust Christ and expect that Christ will fulfill the promise that whosoever is in Christ will have everlasting life. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for this time, both in song and from the Word, to hear the story of Resurrection Day. Please speak to our hearts in this final moment of our service. Please help each and every one to be honest and open before you. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. I'd like to just ask a question or two so I know how to say my closing prayer. I'd like to ask, first of all, how many in this room have had a time in their life when they came to an understanding that they were sinners? You came to the understanding that Jesus was perfect and sinless, that Jesus shed his blood, that he rose again, and you have placed all of your expectation for heaven in Christ. There's a time when you have been born again like Nicodemus. You put your faith in the finished work of Jesus. You're not trusting a church, a pastor, a pope, a priest. And you have at this very moment the expectation in your heart that one day you will see the Lord Jesus Christ face to face. If that is your Bible-based expectation today, would you just take a moment to lift your hand kindly so I may see who you are today? Thank you and God bless you. You may put your hands down. For those of you that did not raise your hand, thank you for being honest today. I want to just take a moment to encourage you today. I want you to know, first of all, you're with friends, and secondly, I want you to know the Lord loves you, and I'm so glad you're here today personally as well. If you did not raise your hand just a moment ago, would you mind just looking right up here at me? There were many of you. Don't be embarrassed. Just look here. I'd like to speak to you for a moment. Friend, Jesus Christ paid the price. He died on the cross. He rose again to prove that he is the Son of God. And the Bible says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It's something that any one of us can do even today. And this morning, in just a moment, we're going to stand and we're going to sing a song of invitation. You don't even have to worry about the words. The choir will sing it. If you want to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, if you want to have an expectation of hope that's based on the evidence of Scripture, then I'm going to invite you to come and just join me here at the front. And I'm going to take a moment to meet you, and then we're going to have a word of prayer. And I'm going to encourage you in prayer to ask Jesus Christ to come to be your Savior, to cleanse your sins, and to give you a home in heaven. It's the greatest decision you'll ever make. I promise you'll never regret it. You have nothing to lose and everything to gain. Friend, the only one that can take us to heaven is the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm praying for you. Thank you for being here today. Father, bless these my friends who I just spoke to. Father, may many of them today, may every one of them that do not presently have that expectation of heaven, may they come and receive the free gift today of salvation. And I pray and ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Let's stand together. Brother Williams will lead us in the song. May I have your attention just very, very momentarily here. We'll be done in a moment. right now, friend, if you're not 100% sure that you have the expectation of heaven, I'm going to invite you as soon as the song begins just to come and meet me here at the front and just say, I want to make sure that Christ is in my life, that I have the expectation of heaven. We'll have a word of prayer together in just a moment. As the song begins, if Christ is dealing with your heart, you come right now. I'll meet
Lord,
you right down
I
here.
Come,
just come right here.
I confess.
Those of you that I talked to just a moment ago, you come.
I find my rest.
God spoke in your heart. Come right down here. We'll have a word of prayer in just a moment. God bless you.
I'd fall apart.
Who else would like to come today and trust Christ as their Savior? Just come. No need to be embarrassed.
Lord,
I need you. God spoke to you. You come. We'll wait for you this morning. God bless you. Come on. You know who you are. Just come today. God spoke in your heart.
Defense,
who else would like to have the expectation of the Lord Jesus Christ and a hope in heaven? I'm going to sing in one more verse. If God's speaking in your heart, just come on down. Hi, how are you? Hi.
Lord, I come.
Is there someone else that would like to receive Christ today? Lord, I come.
Here I find my rest. And
I want to know
you,
that heaven is my home.
I'd fall
you come.
Apart.
Good
You're
morning.
The one that guides my heart.
Who else would join these dear ones?
Lord, I need
Good
you.
Morning.
Oh, I need you.
Lord, I need you. I humbly say
Every
it. I need the Lord. I need the Lord in my life.
You.
Sir, would you set aside whatever you're thinking
defense.
And humble yourself before the Lord and come to Christ today.
Oh God, how I need you.
I'm going to have the choir in just a moment sing just one more verse. Many of you said, I know that I have the expectation of heaven. Others of you did not raise your hand. I want to encourage you today, you can leave this room knowing it. Don't hold on to that chair. If God speak into your heart, join these wonderful folks here as we sing this last verse. This is for you. If you want to settle your relationship with the Lord based on the evidence of Scripture, come with your wife, come with your friend, whoever you might be with, but don't leave this place without trusting the resurrected Savior. This is the last verse of the song.
Lord, I
come. If God spoke to your heart now, just step right out.
I confess,
we'll wait for you. Don't be embarrassed at all. You come with your friend today.
I find my rest, and without you, I'd fall apart. You're the one.
God spoke to your heart. You come.
My
Good morning.
Heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you.
Jesus said, I'm the resurrection and the life.
Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
Ladies, come over here with me and let me just talk to you folks that are right here at the front. If you didn't come up to the front because you're just not sure of that, but you don't have the expectation of heaven, I want you to listen very carefully as I speak to these dear folks right here. First of all, we're so glad you came today and we're so very happy that you're here. Such a blessing. I want to just ask you a couple questions that I'm going to help you pray. And so that you can know for sure that Jesus Christ is your eternal hope. First of all, do we all know that we're sinners? We're not perfect. We fall short of God's glory. That's the easy one, isn't it? And we're all sinners. And do you believe that Jesus Christ was not just another person, but that he was God in the flesh? That when he died on the cross, his blood was shed for your sin? Do you believe in the death of Jesus Christ for you? And in the resurrection of Jesus Christ for you as well? He died and he rose again for you. Then right now what I'd like to do is help you all to just take a moment to pray and to call out to the Lord and ask him to come into your heart and be your Savior. Just claim his promise that if you believe in him, you'll have everlasting life. And I'll help you with this prayer. I want you to mean it from all of your heart. Think about it as we pray. And I'll say the words, and then you say them after me, and let's say them out loud. And let's all bow our heads now as these are going to pray. And some of you out there may pray this as well. Pray out loud with us if you like. But all of you right here at the front, let's pray together right now. Follow me. Dear Lord Jesus, I confess to you that I am a sinner. And I ask you, Lord Jesus, to forgive my sin. And to come into my life. To be my Savior. I'm trusting only in you. And in your shed blood. And in your resurrection. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Hey, let's celebrate with these folks and congratulate them. The Bible says, these things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have everlasting life. Don't ever wonder about God's love or everlasting life. He says, I want you to know it. I want you to be settled with that. And so we really do congratulate you. And we've got, for you ladies here, we've got some ladies on this side. We're going to give you a Bible and make a record of your visit and talk to you about some next steps. And everybody from this side, follow this gentleman right here. We want to give you all a Bible too. Congratulations. Let's congratulate these folks as they make their way out to get their gift. And you all can come this way here. Good. Okay. Wonderful. If there's someone here that just still has some questions, I'll be out at the West Wing lobby. I'll be glad to speak to you today. We want everybody to know Christ. We want everybody to have the expectation that only Jesus Christ can give. And so thank you for listening so well. Before we head out to a lot of other things, let's take a minute and watch a quick video to tell you about where to go and what's coming up next at Lancaster Baptist Church. You may be seated.
Every mom and every child deserve a community of prayer and support. Being a mom and raising kids in today's environment is challenging. And that is why this Mother's Day, May 12th, we will take time in our 10:45 a.m. service to recognize and honor all moms. We will have a time of prayer asking God to give us wisdom and direction as we raise our children.
Every married couple is invited to join us Saturday, April 27th, for a one-day marriage conference at the Walther Center. You and your spouse will enjoy an opening session from Pastor Chappell, and will have a chance to attend split sessions with topics like navigating life's challenges together and building strong foundations for children, vision, values, and expectations for young couples, and other sessions that will strengthen your marriage. The cost is $45 per couple, and that includes lunch. On-campus child care will be provided through sixth grade for $15 per child. You can sign up at lancasterbaptist.org or the church app today.
Are you tired of feeling overwhelmed by life's challenges? Ready to step into a life of boldness and confidence? Join us for Courageous Living, a powerful sermon series with Pastor Paul Chappell, which will uncover biblical strategies for overcoming struggles with courage and conviction. Let's embrace a life of fearless living together. Join us every Sunday at Lancaster Baptist Church. Courageous living, because God made you to be more than a conqueror.
Sunday, May 5th, Lancaster Baptist Church will be hosting a special service to honor the first responders of the Antelope Valley. We love our police officers, firefighters, and medical staff, and want to take some time to appreciate all you do for our community. Join us at our 10:45 service as we thank these faithful servants.
To really experience Lancaster Baptist Church, you have to check out one of our adult connection groups. These small groups meet weekly on Sunday mornings at 9:45. These groups provide opportunities for meaningful friendships as well as valuable Bible instruction tailored for your life stage. Whether you are single or married, young or old, or somewhere in between, there is a connection group where you can find encouragement and acceptance. Pick one out and give it a try next week.
Teens in 7th through 12th grades, the Ascend Youth Conference is Wednesday through Friday, April 10th through the 12th. You will not want to miss the three-day, action-packed, memory-making event with powerful preaching, amazing games, and a trip to Knott's Berry Farms with hundreds of teens from across America. Register today at wcbcyc.com.
Just a few minutes after the conclusion of this service, you are invited to pick up your kids from childcare and bring them down to the athletic field to enjoy a giant Easter egg hunt, bounce houses, and refreshments.
If you're a guest with us today, welcome. We have a gift specifically for you that you may have already received on the way in. But if you did not receive it yet, we invite you to stop by one of the tables in the lobbies where you can pick up your gift bag. Inside is a devotional book from our pastor.
Thanks for joining us. Remember, next weekend, we return to our normal service schedule each Sunday at 8:15 or 10:45. As always, you can find out details about everything going on at Lancaster Baptist on our mobile app or our website, lancasterbaptist.org. You can also follow us on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter.
Well, before we dismiss, we'd like to celebrate some baptisms. And so if you would turn your attention to the screen, what a wonderful day to get baptized to rejoice in the resurrection of Jesus. Brother Furso, if you would take.
In Acts chapter number 2, verse 41, the Bible says, "Then they that gladly received his word were baptized, and it was added unto them about 3,000 souls. This morning, rejoice with these who have accepted Christ as their Savior. Now they're taking that first step of obedience to identify with the Lord's death, his burial, and his resurrection." Mark Ruse. Mark, have you accepted Christ as your Savior?
Yes, sir.
On that public profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Bear the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection. Victoria. Victoria, have you accepted Christ as your Savior?
I have.
On that public profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Bear the likeness of his death. Raise the likeness of his resurrection. Brandon, have you accepted Christ as your Savior?
Yes.
On that public profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Bear the likeness of his death. Raise the likeness of his resurrection.
Let's all stand together, and as you're standing, let's continue to clap and thank the choir and the orchestra for all the work that they put into this weekend. We're so grateful once again for everyone that joined us today, especially our guest. If you had a chance to fill out that guest card, drop it off at one of the tables. We've got a gift for you. We'd love to get the opportunity to meet you as well. And also for the families, we've got fun on the field that's going to begin in just a few moments. And so the kids will certainly enjoy that. I know my kids will. We got the air bounces out there. And then if you've got your family together and you'd like to get a nice Easter photo, we've got some great opportunities for that outside of the West Wing as well. Thanks again for being here today. Have a great day and happy resurrection.